Hi, I'm Travis, and you're watching Curious Tangents. And contrary to popular belief, Superman was not the first superhero. That's an honor that goes to Mandrake the Magician. He had the power to make anyone believe anything with a wave of a hand. It's suspiciously similar to Jedi mind tricks and eerily similar to social media. Mandrake the Magician predates Superman by a full 4 years, making his debut in 1934. However, if we're expanding the definition to superhumans rather than superheroes, then we can go back a full 4,000 years to the first known piece of literature, the Epic of Gilgamesh. Gilgamesh was a real person who actually ruled over Mesopotamia, though he probably didn't have all of the abilities that were left behind in his epic. In the Epic of Gilgamesh, Gilgamesh is granted the powers of immortality and super strength. This means that for as long as humanity has been telling stories, or at least as long as we have been able to preserve those stories, we have been creating versions of us, but better. And today we have science. Can we make what is frequently referred to as an enhanced or designer baby, or maybe even something akin to a superhuman? And if yes, should we? Now, I'm not a geneticist, nor do I work with CRISPR, but my friend and fellow YouTuber Dr.Nemo is.
Can we make genetically enhanced babies? That is a very good question, and the short answer is theoretically yes, but technically it's a bit complicated. It all depends on what you mean by enhancement, because of course we cannot make flying babies or babies shooting lasers from their eyes. We have the tools to edit human genes, and we can use them to fix some genetic diseases, like muscular dystrophy or some form of blindness. But between can we do it and should we do it, there's another very important question, which is can we do it safely? We have sequenced the entire human genome, but this doesn't mean that we know everything about it. We are actually very far from that goal. When it comes to edit human genes, you have to take it like modifying your car. Some genetic diseases are caused by mutation on one single gene. In the car analogy, it's like having a broken cable, and because of that, your car doesn't start. What do you do? Well, what you do is that you replace the broken cable with another original one. But if what you want to do is to insert a new gene that was not there before, it's like taking the motor of a Dodge Viper and put it inside a Honda Civic. You might succeed in fitting it in there, but this might not work, simply because you have to take into consideration all the synergies between the motor and the other parts of the car. The same way, you might succeed in modifying or inserting a new gene inside the human genome. You cannot exclude that this new gene will have synergies with other genes that might result in consequences that are worse than your initial state. Even though our genome can be sequenced linearly, it is important to know that all its parts work together in an incredibly complex network of interactions. In fact, our current knowledge doesn't allow us to say with 100% certainty, yes, we can modify the eyes of this baby without causing any harm. And this is a very valid reason not to do it yet. But let's assume we know everything about our genome and that we are 100% sure that any form of gene editing will not cause any harm to a human embryo. Should we make genetically enhanced babies? And by the way, Travis, what do you mean by enhancement?
Well, I suppose we could control their height and muscle mass and make them more intelligent.
Are you designing a baby to make a future human being stronger, taller, and smarter than average? If yes, and if you consider that those characteristics will give a better life to your child, then why not do it? If it's okay to fix or prevent terrible genetic diseases, how is that different from designing his or her height or intelligence? In the first case, you're just trying to make sure that your child will be physiologically healthier. In the other case, you want your child to be socially healthier. All you want to do is to increase the odds that your child will live the best life possible. But maybe, by designing a baby that matches the current standards for beauty and success in society, the only thing you are doing is just promoting and perpetuating a wrong message. a message that says that the height, the weight, the strength and intelligence, but also the color of the skin, of the eyes, of the hair of your child will define how good a life he or she will live. But because CRISPR can be used for controversial things, it doesn't mean we should stop using CRISPR for good things. We should know where to draw the line between medical therapy and enhancement. Not just because it's fun to play with definitions, which I love, but because it's super important to define which are basic levels of physiological functioning and what are, well, customizations. The first one should be part of our human rights. The other is a bit less necessary.
You know, Nemo, that's a really good point. Most differences between individuals aren't so-called enhancements, they're just customizations. Some customizations will fit society standards and some may not. The idea of allowing people to choose their own customizations for their children or create designer babies comes with a slew of ethical dilemmas. There are some who would say that ethics don't even need to be a part of the discussion, quoting people like Joseph Mengele, who said you would be amazed at what science would do when you get rid of a little thing called ethics. In this unregulated approach, what we oftentimes omit is that Mengele was a Nazi, and not like a frilly new Nazi, like an actual Nazi. Something that most of us understand to be wrong, which is a semblance that we can have some semblance of what is right and what is wrong. A school of thought called evolutionary humanism would argue that it is our moral responsibility to progress the species as far as we possibly can, and if that is by gene editing that leaves some of the population behind, then that's the right thing to do. Another school of thought called social humanism would argue that the technology, in order to be used, must be democratized, that the only way to use it properly is if everyone can use it. Now, the problem with the evolutionary humanist school of thought on genetic editing is rather obvious. It would exclude a significant portion of the population. In fact, I am literally paraphrasing part of the definition of eugenics. Don't do that. There are also problems with the social humanist perspective. Even if everyone has access to the same technology, not everyone will use it. And those who do not will put their children at a significant disadvantage as opposed to those who did. It's important to note that most genetic editing is done in such a way that it will not be passed down more than one generation, meaning that if you edit an embryo, then when that embryo is an adult, its offspring will not have the same mutation. This is because we don't edit a thing called germline cells, which are basically just the reproductive cells, or what goes into making the next human. This means that we can probably use CRISPR and avoid creating a lineage of superhumans descended from the super rich. Probably. Now, it may sound like we're talking about something that needs to be discussed in the far future, like it's almost science fiction, but it's not science fiction. In fact, it's just science. Primarily because it's already been done. The first CRISPR-edited babies carried to term were born in 2018. Late November of 2018, Dr. Huzhuang Hai performed the very first CRISPR operation on a baby carried to term. This is illegal, partly because we cannot guarantee that this can be done safely, but also because it was completely unnecessary. The father of the twins was HIV positive. However, the twins were conceived via IVF, or in vitro fertilization, meaning that they were already selected to not have HIV. Huzhuang Kwai and researchers would remove the CCR5 gene, related to the immune system and particularly the functioning of HIV. But another interesting fact about this gene is that it appears to be related to learning, meaning that when these kids grow up, it will likely have had a positive effect on their ability to learn. Dr. Hua, in 2019, would receive a 3-year prison sentence for this experiment. There was also a third genetically edited baby, product of Huzhuang Kwai, though not related to the other two. It's incredibly likely that one day we will know CRISPR well enough that we can use it reliably, like other medications. It might have downsides, but we'll know them the same way that we know the side effects of most medicines. However, will we ever be smart enough to guide our own evolution? Not just anywhere, but to a place that we would actually like to be. I don't know, and I don't know that anyone else knows either. But the best thing that we can do with issues that are yet to be faced is to face them, to think about them, and to talk about them. Happy thinking, and thanks for watching. I'm expecting the comment section on this video to be rather busy considering the heavy topic subject that we just covered. If you like this video, like and subscribe, and check out my friend Nemo. Links to his videos probably all over the description and in the comment section. Until next time, special thanks to all of my Patreons, especially John Green, who makes stuff like this possible. And I'll see you soon. Huizhuang Hai was sentenced to 3 years in prison. Shoot, Huizhuang Hai. God, that's not right.